Good morning and welcome to the 11th meeting of 2023 in session 6 of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. This morning we have received apologies from Karen Adam. Agenda item 1 is the agreement to consider evidence in private at 9:45. So our first agenda item is to agree to take item 5, which is consideration of today's evidence in private. Are we all agreed? Thank you. And moving on to agenda item 2 is to take evidence on 2 affirmative statutory instruments. These are the First Tier Tribunal for Scotland General Regulatory Chamber and Upper Tribunal for Scotland, Composition and Rules of Procedure, Miscellaneous Amendment Regulations 2023 Draft, and the First Tier Tribunal for Scotland, Allocation of Funds to the General Regulatory Chamber, Regulations 2023 Draft. And I refer members to Paper 1 and welcome to the meeting Siobhan Brown, Minister for Victims, Community Safety, and she is accompanied by Marcus Tarmers, who is the Senior Policy Officer, and Emma Thompson, Solicitor, Legal Directorate of the Scottish Government. I recognise that this is the first appearance of the Minister before this committee since her appointment. Welcome, Minister, and please can I invite you to speak to the instrument before us.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Committee. This suite of 2 regulations will expand the functions of the First Tier Tribunal for Scotland General Regulatory Chamber to include hearing appeals against decisions of a local authority to issue penalty charge notices in relation to the low emission zone scheme, workplace parking licensing scheme, and drop footway parking, double parking, and pavement parking prohibitions. They will also amend the Chamber's composition and procedure rules to include these appeals. The Scottish Tribunal structure was created by the Tribunals Scotland Act 2014, which introduced a new simplified statutory framework for tribunals in Scotland. It consists of the First Tier Tribunal and the Upper Tribunal. The Transport Scotland Act 2019 provides legislation enabling the creation of low emission zones, workplace parking schemes, and these new parking prohibitions. The Act allows for the civil enforcement of all by the local authorities. The route of appeal against local authority penalty charge notices for each of these is in the First Tier Tribunal. The first instrument before you is the First Tier Tribunal for Scotland, Allocation of Functions to the General Regulatory Chamber, Regulations 2023. These regulations provide for an allocation of the appeal functions mentioned in the General Regulatory Chamber for the First Tier Tribunal. The second of these regulations is the First Tier of Tribunal for Scotland, General Regulatory Chamber and Upper Tribunal for Scotland, Composition and Rules of Procedure, Miscellaneous Amendment Regulations 2023. These regulations amend existing regulations that make provision in relation to the rules of procedure of the General Regulatory Chamber when hearing parking and bus lane appeals. Those rules of procedure will apply with modifications to appeals against decisions of the local authority to issue penalty charges notices relating to the new low emission zone scheme, workplace parking schemes, and the new parking prohibitions. The rules will now refer to transport appeals to include all new and existing appeals. These regulations also amend the existing composition regulations for the General Regulatory Chamber when hearing parking and bus lane appeals. This provides for the new appeals to be heard by a legal member alone in the First Tier Tribunal, as in the case with the parking and bus lane appeal. The Scottish Tribunals will be able to hear such appeals as of the 1st of June 2023. It is the case that these 2 instruments play a part in enabling the General Regulatory Chamber to hear these new appeals. I understand that the DPLR committee considered these regulations on the 28th of March and there were no points raised. I am happy to answer any questions, Convener.
Any questions from the committee? No. Can I just say on a personal level and a professional that I'm pleased to see this come before, because it was in fact the pavement parking bill that was introduced by my predecessor, Sandra White, during her time. So I'm sure she'll be delighted to see that this is actually coming to fruition. So thank you. Thank you. No other member of the committee
Lina,
has.
Sorry. Do we need to formally move the SSIs?
Oh. No other member of the committee has indicated that they wish to ask any questions or make any comments. So we will move straight to agenda item 3, which is the formal business in relation to the instruments. Agenda item 3 is considerations of the motions for approval of the affirmative instruments, and I invite the Minister to move motions S6M 08337 and S6M 08338. Minister?
Formally move, Convener.
Do members have any final comments? If not, are we all agreed? Agreed. I invite the committee to agree to delegate to me the publication of a short factual report on our deliberations of the affirmative SSIs that we have considered today. Are we all agreed? That completes the consideration of the affirmative instruments. I thank the Minister and her officials for attending, and we shall pause briefly before moving on to the next agenda item. Thank you. Our next item of business is continuation of evidence on asylum seekers in Scotland. We will take evidence from two panels this morning, and I welcome our first panel, Brona Andrew, Operations Manager at TARA, which stands for Trafficking Awareness Raising Alliance. Welcome. Superintendent Claire Dobson, Partnerships Prevention Community Wellbeing Division, and to Chief Inspector Elaine Thompson, Safer Communities Team, Greater Glasgow Division, Police Scotland. You are all very welcome. And to members, I refer you to papers 2 and 3, and after they have made their opening statements, I will invite each of you to do your line of questioning. But prior to that, could I ask Brona if you would like to go first?
Okay, thank you, Convener and Committee members. I'm pleased to have been asked to join the panel this morning and to see the letter from our lived experience group included in your papers. TARA have been providing government-funded support to women survivors of sex trafficking since 2005, and we have witnessed the evolution of our collective response to trafficking for nearly 20 years. I will speak to this experience and the vulnerability of women, but many of our concerns will be shared for men and children. The Nationality and Borders Act brought significant and concerning changes to our current process for identifying and protecting victims, but we are shocked at the wholesale dismantling of the vital and life-saving support for survivors being proposed by the Illegal Migration Bill. During 2021 and 2022, we supported 156 individual women, of whom 138 were seeking asylum or were undocumented at the point of referral to our service. It's probable that had the Illegal Migration Bill been in place, those women would not have been able to access our support. Indeed, we consider the removal of support to only benefit human traffickers and perpetrators of abuse, as the removal of protections for those 138 vulnerable women would have meant they remained sexually exploited, generating approximately £36 million over a 2-year period from the Scottish sex industry for the traffickers. We are also of the view that the current increased normalisation of hotels to accommodate those seeking asylum will create a ready-made group of vulnerable women easily accessed by traffickers. Such groups of already traumatised women experiencing poverty, uncertainty and isolation are acutely vulnerable to traffickers, and we already have many women in our service who were accommodated in hotels elsewhere in the UK who were then approached by traffickers and sexually exploited throughout the UK. The UK was considered to be a global leader in the fight against human trafficking and exploitation, with the support provided in Scotland, although not perfect, considered to be ahead of the curve. This can no longer be held to be the case. Thank you.
Thank you. Claire?
Good morning. My name is Claire Dobson and I'm a superintendent in Police Scotland's Partnership Prevention and Community Wellbeing Division. Police Scotland is a values-based organisation with human rights at the centre of all we do, and we are committed to working with our communities. ACC David Duncan has recently been appointed to drive the Policing Together portfolio, demonstrating our commitment in the area of equality, diversity and inclusion. My division has a national focus, and part of that work involves the monitoring of community tensions and matters locally and nationally that impact on our communities. Where we see tensions, we work to support communities as well as our colleagues in local policing divisions to provide this support. Police Scotland is committed to working with asylum seeker communities in supporting and promoting community wellbeing. We do this in a number of ways. As I stated, we monitor community tensions and assess the impacts on our communities via community impact assessment tool. These can be managed and monitored both locally and nationally. We have a number of community advisors representing different communities and regular ongoing engagement with them. We have a national independent strategic advisory group and a number of professional reference groups, as well as Policing Together independent review group. We deliver training to and have a number of hate crime champions across the country, as well as hate crime advisors. And where there is a significant incident or operation, we have the ability to operate a community reassurance cell to monitor and manage community tensions. We also regularly engage with our partners nationally. We seek to increase awareness of behaviours that constitute hate crime, as can be seen from our recent campaign Don't Feed the Hate Monster, and seek to encourage people to report hate crime to us, and also how they can do this, such as via third-party reporting centres. And where hate crime is reported, we will carry out thorough and robust investigations. We work closely with our colleagues in local policing, who engage directly with asylum seekers on a daily basis and listen to their lived and living experiences. Our officers carry out a vital role locally in supporting our communities and the operational environment, which my colleague can provide an update on.
Thanks. Thank you, Claire. Elaine?
Good morning. Good morning, everyone. I'm Elaine Tomlinson, Temporary Chief Inspector for Partnerships and Safer Communities in the Greater Glasgow Division of Local Policing of Police Scotland. Thank you so much for this invite to be here this morning, and we're absolutely honoured to be here representing the voice of local policing. My role concentrates on continually enhancing collaborative work in Greater Glasgow Division. We accept we can't do everything on our own, and partnership working is beneficial to us all. I hope this morning to provide you with an overview of the challenges and best practices in local policing, whilst also providing you with a broader awareness of the national situation involving the current asylum seeking process, the officers involved in numerous departments, numerous partners involved, and most importantly, the vulnerable people who are seeking asylum in Scotland. None of us can ever lose sight that families and individuals seeking asylum have been forced to flee their homes and their countries to evade the horrors that we can never ever imagine. Leaving behind their homes, their jobs, their loved ones in the hope of finding the basic privilege of safety. Police Scotland's legislative purpose is to improve the safety and well-being of people, places and communities. We work to the laws of the country, considering all the threats and risks, and we police that accordingly. In Greater Glasgow Division, we have developed the public health approach to policing, which is a vision to ensure our approach and processes better support our public health partners to improve the health and well-being of everyone in our communities. This approach is applied to all areas of our policing, not least engagement and interaction with the vulnerable people we're discussing today, our asylum seekers. We ensure we work collaboratively with our relative partners in an attempt to reduce the trauma, the fear and the anxiety faced by these people. Every person has the right to seek asylum in the UK, and the current process requires each person to attend Home Office or Migrant Help to conduct a screening interview to collect the basic information about their identity and their journey to be here in Scotland. And this is done by obtaining biometric details like fingerprints, a process which was convened by the Refugee Convention of 1971. I hope through discussions today that I will give you an outline of the process through the eyes of our officers and also through the vulnerable people seeking asylum to provide you all with a greater understanding of improvement and best practices. Thank you again for this absolute privilege to be here today, and we would welcome the opportunity to be involved in any subsequent task and finish or working groups which may be created to help in the advance of finding some of these funding some of these sessions. Collaboratively, we realise there's still more work we can all do together, and through shared learning, we can enhance that current work. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Thank you to all three of you for your opening statements. I'll kick us off about legislative context, but just with an opening question, and then I think my colleagues, Pam and Rachel, are interested in the impact of the bill, so they'll come in very quickly after me. The Scottish Government has said that the bill would amend the powers and duties of Scottish ministers to provide support and assistance to victims and potential victims under the Human Trafficking and Exploitation Scotland Act 2015. But the committee has also heard concerns that the bill would exacerbate exploitation and trafficking in Scotland. So as an opening sort of question to get us going, how are victims of human trafficking and exploitation currently supported in Scotland? And do you think that the bill will make their situation worse? So, Brona, could I ask you to come in first on that, please?
So, at the moment, the Scottish Government funds TARA to provide specialist support to adult women trafficked for sexual exploitation, and it also funds our colleagues in Migrant Help to provide similar supports aimed to adult men and women trafficked for other forms of exploitation. That support includes access to temporary safe accommodation, early legal advice, access to health services, and of course access to psychological assessment and treatment. And I know you're going to hear from my colleague Nina later on today. That support is available to for TARA to women at the point of need. Women don't need to have been entered into the national referral mechanism at that point. They can come into our service if there are concerns or indicators of human trafficking. Our support is available 24/7 and is wraparound and is very much led by the woman and is very much trauma informed. That is the support at the moment. We are given a great deal of autonomy around assessment of need and the length of support that is provided. So we are significantly concerned at the proposals within the Legal Migration Bill to disapply the Scottish Government's powers to provide that support on the ground.
Okay, thank you. Can you expand a little bit about your concern, about your last sentence there?
Concern at the moment on the face of what is proposed within the Illegal Migration Bill is that there will be no ability for TARA or equivalent services to reassure women of their protection, that it is almost a disincentive for survivors to come forward to ask for help. What we know and what we've learned over the 20 years I've been involved with TARA is that women are very wary of those in authority, and I include our service within that, that quite often traffickers have told women they are here illegally, they will either be imprisoned or they will be deported immediately if they come forward for support. At the moment, we are able to provide reassurance that that isn't the case, that with legal advice, access to the NRM, that there is a degree of protection. If the bill is enacted as it is now, we will no longer be able to offer that reassurance. So there's a clear disincentive for survivors to come forward to services like ourselves to look for support. And that will have a knock-on effect in that we can't then link them into our colleagues in Police Scotland and support those women to access justice.
Thank you. Thanks for that, Brona, for clarifying that. Very important to get that on record. Could I get a view from, I'm wondering whether either both or either Claire or Elaine, which one would be best to take it? Claire?
Convener, could I suggest that Elaine could take the support question, yeah, and I can cover the potential impacts of the bill?
Yep, so in relation to the support that Brona's mentioned, we have engagement currently in Glasgow and in other areas where we have asylum seekers, where we're engaging constantly with those asylum seekers and the vulnerable ladies, vulnerable families, making them aware of the police. We're very, very aware when they're coming from other countries that they're potentially fearful of the police because of the culture in their country. And it's about us engaging with those people to make them aware that we're a completely different policing it in respect, and we will engage with them to look after them and protect them, slightly different to what they've maybe seen in their own countries. And we have to engage to get that, the buy-in from them that they will work with us, and we continue to do that through meetings at the hotels. We now meet with them at community engagement events. We're fully embedded in numerous engagements in Glasgow and across the different areas of the country where we have asylum seekers. So be assured that we are providing that reassurance to them.
Okay, thanks. Claire?
So obviously with any new piece of legislation, then we would review it to understand what the impacts might be and changes in relation to how we uphold the law and how we manage that. From a policing perspective, the changes to the bill mean potentially due to the reduced timescales that we obviously, as you're aware, are committed to trauma-informed policing and that education and making sure that we actually get the absolute best evidence from an individual. And sometimes that takes a little bit of time and it takes certain approaches. And there is a concern potentially that there's a specific and set timescale that's shortened where an individual's maybe having to navigate more than one process at one time, that we may not get the best evidence in terms of the offence, if you like, and that they may then disengage with the system. Equally as well, at the moment, whilst leave to remain isn't a guarantee of the process and certainly engaging with the NRM, ultimately, they can be given the time at the moment to work through that process, and they'll be given support by services through TARA and other organisations and agencies to have the time and space as the investigation progresses and to work through that. So given the changes, there is the potential for victims to be less likely to engage in the NRM process and bring themselves forward for the fear that they then would be potentially deported within 30 days. So there is that potential that we may see a fall in engagement with the NRM and an increase in duty to notify from organisations. And probably lastly to mention in terms of potential impacts is that if we find that people are less likely to engage in the NRM process and with support services, it could potentially risk the fostering of human trafficking and exploitation conditions where potential victims could potentially stay in those sectors and stay in those hidden areas of the economy where they are exploited. So, for example, potentially agricultural areas where we've got lack of food production workers, you know, potentially areas that are hidden in the economy because they may not feel that they can come forward. And as I say, that's probably the last one I would cover today.
Thank you. Can I bring in Pam?
Thank you, Chair. Good morning, panel, and thank you so much for your opening statements. Last week, when I asked about trafficking and exploitation, I was told too often that times happen that victims don't want to deal with the police. And so, first instance, sometimes they would go to basically be supported by third sector, maybe. So it might be a joined-up approach that you're working on with the Police Scotland and Third Sector. So my question is around what sort of partnership working do you undertake with the Third Sector in this area? And do you foresee any changes or improvements to be made in the future? And my question really starts off with Elaine, because Elaine, you mentioned the trust and being a woman of BAME background. I understand being in other countries, you know, we went with my mother and everything, the trust with police is very less. So when you mentioned that, that was something that I definitely resonated with. And also just to add to that, is there a language barrier as well?
So, yeah, absolutely happy to come in there, convener. So Pam, thank you for those questions. And absolutely, the engagement, as I've already mentioned, is that we have to deal with these vulnerable people and make them trust us almost. It's bringing that trust in because they've come from countries where the police have completely different policing style. And we have to engage with them, make them understand the policing style that we have, the approach we have. And we work really closely with our third sector partners and we're really proud of that. They are the golden nuggets of doing the work with us. We also have third-party reporting centres, which you maybe be aware of now. So there are 400 over Scotland and over 50 in Glasgow, and that figure is continuing to grow as we engage with more businesses and organisations who want to be involved in that. We have the high street coffee shops now wanting to be involved in it, which is fantastic. Which the opportunity there is for these ladies, if they still don't have that full trust in Police Scotland, we're able to engage with them and tell them to attend at the third-party reporting centres to report the matters, where we've trained the staff there who can then report it back to the police. So there is always an option to come to us, and we will absolutely continue our engagement with our partners. We can't do it alone, and we do accept that. So any other questions, I'm happy to answer.
Just on that, Elaine, is there any change or improvement where the Scottish Government can help a little bit more? And also, do you think there's a change from when you started supporting to now, that the fact that you've reached out to 400 third-party places as well? Do you think change is happening and what can improve?
And absolutely, the change is our learning. It's our understanding that people won't always want to come to the police, and they can come to us via these other measures, then we're absolutely getting them to engage with us, but not directly. They're fearful of coming to a police office, they're fearful of talking to a police officer, and we will continue to break down those barriers. But if we can't break those barriers down, they've got the third-party reporting centres to come to, and our plea would be that we continue to have more of them across Scotland, and we are continuing to train more staff. And that's resource-intensive for us, but it's something that's absolutely vital to Police Scotland. So your support in that would be absolutely beneficial to us. Thank you.
Thank you.
Can I just come in from experience for Tara with trafficking? Quite often we have women referred to us who are very reluctant and wary to speak to the police, but we are able to provide them with space and time to provide them with information about what it would mean to engage with the police and give them options around meeting colleagues within Greater Glasgow's human trafficking unit, just to provide an intelligence statement or whether they wish to make a formal complaint. And we found with that time and space and that approach and working closely with our police colleagues that the majority of women are willing to then speak to the police formally and tell them about their experience. A good example of how partnership working is really important was with Operation Altercation, the court case early last year where I think it was 4 human traffickers were found guilty of trafficking offences in Scotland. Tara worked very closely with our colleagues in the Greater Glasgow Human Trafficking Unit and our colleagues in the Crown Office Victim Service to support 2 vulnerable women to give evidence. Given the length of time it can take from reporting through to the court cases happening, that was a significant period of time. And if it wasn't for close partnership working, I don't believe those witnesses would have remained engaged in the service because they were both acutely vulnerable. And one in particular, I think, may have disengaged. So the ability to have that time and space and that close partnership working with Police Scotland reaps benefits in that traffickers are found guilty and punished for their crime and women achieve justice.
Thank you. Claire, is there anything you want to add?
Yes, actually. We do have 2 victim navigators as well that work are embedded within our human trafficking unit and they provide support to victims in terms of translators and in terms of working with Tara. So, and they've got a national remit so they can be used around the country. I would say as well, nationally, we are doing work. I note some of your comments as well. We are doing work in and around supporting individuals and in and around trying to encourage people with third-party reporting. So there is a lot of work ongoing within the local policing divisions, but nationally, obviously, we've recently supported Scottish Government in some of that work. But nationally, what we're looking to do is try and improve that service because we understand, actually, that that's going to be key in terms of people being feeling safe and coming forward. So we want to fully support that and expand it as much as we can and work with individuals. We're also doing a lot of work in the BAME community as well in terms of the Chief Constable's commitment to become an anti-racist organisation. So we have a... collectively, as a national division, we often support local policing divisions. So Elaine and I have done some work recently in and around the African community. We've worked across over in, from a national perspective, worked nationally across over in Lothians and the Scottish borders and up in Fife. So we are engaged in trying to support all of that as well.
Thank you. And I just want to say that's a great initiative that you put at 400 places out there and people want to add to it because I know that when I'm dealing with domestic abuse and things like that, that's important, those people out there, that they can get that support walking into a coffee place or anything. So great initiative.
Convener, just one final point you mentioned about language barriers. We've had the new Scots Law brochure translated into 10 different languages. So when we have asylum seekers presenting at the hotels in Glasgow, we're presenting it to them in the language that they most understand, which has been absolutely vital to let them understand. And it breaks down policing, it breaks down basic Scottish law, and it gives them a greater understanding of living and living in Glasgow and the surrounding areas. Just I had forgotten to mention that. Thank you.
Thank you for that information. Thank you.
Thank you. I think I have a colleague who's going to go further into sort of like language, so we'll come back to that. Rachel, was there anything else that you wanted to ask about this particular area?
Yeah, well, first of all, the human trafficking statement. There isn't a statement, but the strategy in 2017. It's quite a while ago that that was put in, into this domain. And I just wondered whether there could be some development on that. There isn't a statement as such in terms of modern slavery. There have been calls for that. So there've been, as Bryna said, COVID backlogs with court backlogs. First of all, I want to ask Police Scotland around the preventative strategy so that we know that there are human traffickers bringing women in here into Scotland with the promise of employment. You mentioned there about meeting some of the employment gaps that there are, perhaps you mentioned on farms. Is there a preventative strategy to allow employers to understand that this is happening and to look out for the signs? And secondly, on the point around the court backlogs, what is the percentage of the successful prosecutions? And obviously, human trafficking cases are very complex as well. Are women that are being trafficked aware of the backlog, and does that put them off as well? So there's 2 lots of questions there. Should I start with Police Scotland?
So in terms of preventative strategy, the National Division is looking at creating a preventative strategy across the organisation. So we do a lot of prevention work, and a lot of that prevention work is day-to-day work in and out the hotels and directly with the asylum seekers that Elaine could cover better than me. In terms of specifically a prevention strategy for human trafficking, we obviously are committed to the strategy that was set out in 2017. We've got a dedicated human trafficking unit that does all that work. To give you more detail on the work that they were doing, I would have to get that information and be able to present it back to the committee, because that's certainly not the area that I cover within the organisation. So I could certainly get that information for you. In terms of the percentage of prosecutions, that would be something that would have to be provided by the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service in terms of their figures, in terms of what's reported and what actually comes through in relation to that. But ultimately, we are committed to having those conversations as part, obviously, of one of the strands of the human trafficking strategy, is specifically about that information out to businesses and about that prevention and that knowledge gap and how we actually get out there. We're very keen to engage through our partners in terms of providing and getting information out there. As Elaine said, we're keen to get translation strategies and everything out, documents translated. We were involved in the Safer Communities aspect of the New Scots strategy as well, in terms of some of that content. So we are aware that that's an area that we want to be in.
Okay. That would be great if you could provide those figures, because as I understand it, there's been very little progress in terms of prosecution since 2019. And in 2019, the number of human trafficking cases increased by 50%. So, and I'm very interested in the preventative element of this, rather than letting women go through, you know, this terrible trauma that they're going through. Bronagh, can I bring you in on the
hugely complicated cases, as you can probably imagine, in terms of investigation? They're quite lengthy cases, and they can sometimes span, obviously, more than one country. Essentially as well, so that probably will build in specific delays as well. However, in relation to the prevention strategy and the prosecution figures, we can certainly get that information.
Just on the point about women being put off by kind of, I don't even know if they would realise the extent of the backlog.
Just to concur with Claire, our experience is human trafficking cases and investigations are hugely complex and detailed, and we would expect them to take a period of time, particularly when police are taking a trauma-informed approach and working at the pace of the survivor in that. In terms of the kind of the court backlog putting women off, I have to be honest and say I don't think women are aware of that. They're not aware of our processes. We've supported women who haven't even understood they were in Scotland, never mind understood how our criminal justice system and processes work. That's part of our job, and it's part of the role of Police Scotland and independent legal advice, is to provide women with this context and this information. Women do want justice. I can tell you that, that women do seek justice, and those going through that process, while they might be frustrated at the delay, that frustration is around the trauma they experience and the fact that they want to tell their story, they want to give their evidence, and then they want to move on with their life. And the frustration and anxiety is around the ability to provide and tell their story to the court. But I would say on the whole, women barely understand who Tara are and what our role is, never mind understanding what it means to give to begin that process and the court backlogs.
Thank you.
I'm going to move on to Maggie, please. Bring in Maggie. She is online today.
Thanks very much, Kokab, and good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us. Thank you for what you've said so far, and I'm sorry I can't be with you in person today. I want to explore a couple of questions around the use of hotels and how they either support or don't support you to do the important work that you are needing to do. Rona, if I can come to you first, you mentioned in your opening remarks that one of Tara's concerns is that hotels provide a very ready-made place for traffickers to go and target vulnerable people. Could you say just a little bit more about that, how you've seen that function, if you've seen that work in Scotland, and I suppose particularly looking ahead, how the as we are likely to see the use of more hotels across Scotland, how you see that changing the nature of the work you have to do?
Okay, I can try. So Tara, our support, we provide safe accommodation for a short-term basis. We then ensure women are able to access independent legal advice, and if women wish to do so, we'll support them to make a claim for asylum, and then we will support them to move on into that asylum support process. In order to do that and mitigate, we have regular monthly meetings with our colleagues in Migrant Helps Asylum Help Team, MEERS, to try to troubleshoot and plan for women. Historically, that has meant please don't locate her in this part of the city because exploitation happened there. Could you locate her elsewhere? And to look at that need. Now the concern is the move, and women would move from our accommodation frequently into community accommodation. Our concern now is women being moved into hotels. Unfortunately, hotels are easily identifiable, and if I was a perpetrator, I would know where to go. Women struggle within hotels for isolation, poverty, lots of reasons, and at that point are acutely vulnerable to traffickers grooming those women. And saying, you know, telling lies or grooming them to believe them and go with them. So we are concerned. For Tara, we're able to mitigate that because when women go in, move on from our accommodation, we continue to provide them with support, and that support is robust and dependent on need. So we're able to maintain close contacts with women, which can act as a protective factor, but that's only for the women who are identified and being supported by Tara. There are women in hotels who are not accessing support, who are not being identified as having been trafficked, or who indeed are not being trafficked at this moment, but are vulnerable to traffickers coming with lies to tell them to leave with them, they'll have a better chance of life with them, and then exploitation occurs. And we certainly have experienced that. We have a number of women who were accommodated in asylum hotels in England, who were then groomed and approached by traffickers, sexually exploited throughout the UK and recovered in Scotland.
Okay, thank you. That you paint a pretty bleak picture there. And are you concerned that as we start seeing hotels become institutionalised and the hotel accommodation being used for prolonged periods of time, months if not years, in some areas, that actually this issue is going to be exacerbated?
I think so. The feedback we have from women who are in hotels is that they find it very isolating. They feel quite restricted in their freedom. They struggle with things like basics, like feeding themselves. Quite often our team are providing women with rice cookers in an effort to help them look after themselves. Women come to us and they are... their health is poor, they've not been well fed, nutrition's an issue, and a big part of our role is to try to support those women to feel safe, to look after themselves and begin to get physically well, so they're then able to take on the challenges of recovery and moving forward. And hotels in the short term are difficult enough, but in the long term we are really concerned that women will not be able to begin to move through their trauma and begin to envisage a life of hope and stability where they can make a difference for themselves and, in some cases, their children.
Okay, thanks for that, Bruno. Yeah, I mean, I think we've heard before just the nature of hotel accommodation not being one that is conducive to trauma recovery at all. So it's important that you highlight that. My final question for you, Bruno, is just around that relationship that Tara has with MEERS, as they are the hotel sort of manager, I suppose, in Scotland. How have you found your relationship with MEERS, that those regular engagement meetings that you have with them? Are you able to identify sort of issues early on. OMI is receptive to the kinds of requests that you make of them around transferring particularly vulnerable people, or how would you describe that relationship with MIAS?
We probably have a very good relationship with MIAS. They're very sympathetic to our approaches. I think that has been based on that regular monthly health and housing multi-agency conference where we all get around the table and issues are identified as an opportunity to troubleshoot, and we all take on actions in order. So the women's very much at the centre of that. And I think because of that, we certainly have been able to have a positive working relationship with MIAS within the context of what's become increasingly restrictive. Does that make sense?
Okay. Thanks very much for that, Bruno. Yeah, no, that does make sense. If I could move on to Police Scotland, Claire, Elaine, I'm not sure which of you wants to take these questions, but very similar questions around the partnership working and that multi-agency engagement that Bruno has spoken about and you've mentioned too. How is your engagement with MIAS? What kind of notice do you get from them when new hotels are going to start being used for asylum seekers? How would you describe your partnership working, your relationship with them?
So I would say at a national level, we are involved in kind of broader national meetings, essentially in and around COSLA and with MIAS. We also support the local policing divisions. So each local policing division, where there is a hotel, there are structures in place and there are strong partnership links. So there are discussions with local authorities, with MIAS and with other health and social care partnerships around the table. So there is a lot of discussion in terms of that delivery, what support's in place and where there is support that's potentially lacking, that MIAS can kind of come to the table, have those discussions and have that understanding. That probably looks just slightly differently around the country because we are dealing with different local authorities around the country. So localised structures and local authority structures may be slightly different, but there are, Elaine can probably give a bit more information from a divisional perspective, but there are liaisons divisionally with the hotels or liaisons specifically with local policing, with local authority. There are briefings for local councillors and there are briefings for community, and there's work done in the community as well in terms of integration. So there is a lot of discussion and a lot of communication ongoing. So that's probably a broad overview from a national perspective, but obviously Elaine can give you it from a local policing division perspective and how that looks.
Super. Thanks. Yes, Elaine, if you would. And I suppose particularly I'm interested in the hotel connection and the information that you get, the information that you need around that.
Yep, absolutely. I can come in on that from a Glasgow perspective and a local policing perspective. So in Greater Glasgow Division, we were the first division in Police Scotland to have an asylum seeker liaison officer who was predominantly dealing directly with MIAS and linked in with MIAS and attends the delivery and procurement meeting. COSLA go to that with the council, MIAS and ourselves. We all go along to that meeting and we discuss all matters relating to the hotels. And we also have our internal partnership working with our own human trafficking team that Brona's mentioned, and obviously linking in with Tara as well. So we have those meetings there, and we have that time, the time and space to discuss any concerns we have with the hotels, and we can assist with any developments moving forward. You mentioned notice periods. The notice period has always been sufficient for our senior management team and the MIAS head of operations to introduce any plans and local concerns before we take anything further. And as I previously mentioned in my presentation, that we have the engagement with the hotels through our local, through the asylum seeking liaison officer, but more importantly through our community policing officers who go into the hotels. And the other safety element we have is where we have to educate the staff and give them an awareness of these asylum seekers and the vulnerabilities that they have. And we've fully engaged with them and embedded with that work there, that they have a much greater awareness and they will report any matters to us. I hope that answers your question. Maggie, anything else, let me know.
Thanks, Elaine. That's really helpful and good to have that fleshed out like that. I suppose I've got another question still focused on hotel use, but thinking about how, as you know, on the ground, how you engage with local communities and when a hotel either has been newly identified or has been in use for asylum seekers for some time. How is it that you feel community relations and the engagement that you have responsibility for, how do you feel that goes? And are there things that we need to be thinking about given the changes that could come in with the new legislation, with how we engage with local communities where hotels are in use?
Yeah, I'll come back in there from a Glasgow perspective and other local policing areas. We're fully engaged and we will continue to be engaged. And we're also mindful of the community tensions that can be in our local communities where we've already got engagement. And we need to work with our local communities, explaining the situation to them, understanding them. And it's about listening and listening properly to people's concerns and making sure that we're taking everyone's concerns into consideration when we put plans in place. And then we link back in and have our collaboration opportunities to link in and raise our concerns and issues. And through our collaborative work, we can reach the most agreeable solution for all parties concerned. So we do continually engage with the communities at a local level and then again at a national level through Claire's team. So we do have that covered, Maggie. Thank you.
Okay. And I suppose linked to that, in the same way as hotels might be a sort of a target site for traffickers and people who want to exploit the vulnerable asylum seekers, do you also are you also the view that hotels can be a site for targeting by far-right extremists? You know, we've seen what's happened in Erskine, for instance. Do you have a concern around that with prolonged and extended use of hotels?
There. If I could get a brief answer, I'm just conscious of the time and I'm also mindful that we will be taking evidence on that particular issue in greater detail in the forthcoming weeks. So a brief answer, please.
The brief answer would be that we are well aware of the hotel at Erskine that you've specifically mentioned and the reassurance that the local policing staff, the senior management team are fully aware of it, engaging with both communities to ensure that they're both given their voice and both listened to.
And ultimately, sorry, apologies, but we do have community impact assessment structures in place so that we have a structured process so that we can record any tensions, we can manage them and monitor them, and we can mitigate the risks and we can put actions in place to make sure, and that will be monitored both nationally and locally.
Thanks, Elaine. Thanks.
Thank you. Can I bring Fulton in, please? Would you prefer it if... Yeah, no problem at all. I was conscious that you're ending up being last. Paul.
thank you very much, convener. I just wanted to tail into the conversation about the legislation and about indeed what can be done within devolved competence in terms of these issues. So, you know, the Scottish Refugee Council have called on the Scottish Government to use its powers under Section 9 of the Human Trafficking and Exploitation Scotland Act of 2015 to look at creating an anti-trafficking protection process, essentially, that would bypass that NRM. And I just wondered to what extent, you know, do the panel feel that would be useful in terms of protecting our obligations under the EHRC, you know, Section 4 obligations? And I wonder if I can maybe start with Brona just to get a sense of, you know, do you want to see the government push that forward?
So for a long time, Tara have been very supportive of what we would call a Scottish NRM. At the minute, the National Referral Mechanism is owned by the Home Office. It is a bureaucratic process where named first responders complete an online form. It goes to one of two competent authorities, the caseworkers within that, who make a decision on whether somebody is potentially a victim, and then a second decision about whether somebody is conclusively a victim, very much based on paper. And that tends to happen remote to the survivor. So for a number of times since even before the human trafficking legislation in Scotland, we were supportive of a Scottish-based NRM that was more local and closer to the survivor and those services providing that support on the ground. So we would be supportive of a Scottish identification and protection system, which are the obligations and duties conferred to Scotland at the moment. I know there are concerns around immigration status and that being retained by Westminster, but I don't think those are insurmountable, and I think agreement could be reached on that. My concern with that is that the illegal migration bill within clause 23 would disapply the Scottish Government's power to create their own identification and protection system, which is why we are so shocked and alarmed at the content of what's within the bill.
Thank you for that, Rona. Sorry, I'll correct my acronym. It's ECHR. I do that all the time, so apologies for that, for the record. I think that's helpful. I mean, what's your sense, you know, notwithstanding the challenges that the Illegal Migration Bill presents, what's your sense in terms of engagement with ministers on this? You know, has there been a degree of work done already in this space to look at a different referral mechanism?
What's happened within government and ministers around that, but certainly there's been active listening around that proposal, more recently than there has been historically, but it's certainly a model that is open. At the moment, Glasgow City Council are participating in a devolved pilot decision-making for children around trafficking decisions. And I think their experience, if you haven't heard it already, would be useful to the committee around the difference it makes for the decision-makers to be closer to that child and a better quality of decision coming from that, and therefore protection.
Thank you. I appreciate Police Scotland maybe, you know, limited in terms of their opinion of what can be done in the devolved competence, but I wonder if, in the terms of the practicalities, if you might be able to say something about would a different referral mechanism be helpful to you, just to give you that opportunity.
So it's not really for Police Scotland to comment on. Ultimately, what we want to do is protect the vulnerable, and that's most important to us. Obviously, the NRM and immigration is a reserved matter, but we wouldn't really comment any further in relation to that.
Okay, if I can, Convener, you know, you mentioned there Police Scotland's interest in protecting the most vulnerable. I wonder, can I ask about, I suppose, your approaches in terms of how you support people at the moment? Obviously, there is a practice in relation to holding people under immigration legislation in custody, in suites or in cells. And I know that's particularly concerning for people who are, you know, saying quite clearly that they are a victim of human trafficking, very often, in some cases, have left a really dangerous situation and then have been held in custody. So I wonder to what extent would you recognise that those are an additional barrier, essentially, to trying to go through the processes of supporting someone who's been a victim of human trafficking? And do you recognise that the Angelina Review had actually identified that as being an additional barrier? And do you think there is more that we can do to find alternatives in order to process people?
Ultimately, we are an organisation that works within the confines of the law, and we uphold the law and we work within that. The current processes are that where a person presents, they present to migrant help or they present to a police station, and subsequently they work through the system in that way. Elaine can actually give you an overview of what that looks like, and if you would like that, in terms of how that process goes. Ultimately, as an organisation, we will always work within the confines of the law when it comes to immigration and people presenting.
So I think it would be helpful, Convener, if Elaine can say something, because I'm particularly interested in, I appreciate what you say about the confines of the law, but how do we ensure that everyone has access to interpretation services, healthcare, welfare? You know, is it your view that that's happening across the piece just now in Police Scotland? And perhaps Elaine might be able to say more.
In terms of custody, what I can assure you is that everybody gets access to healthcare within custody. Everybody gets access to interpreters or translators where they're required to in custody. everybody gets access to. There are various support mechanisms around the country, just in terms of referrals and onward referrals, whether it might be they're experiencing issues with domestic abuse. I've previously been a custody sergeant myself a number of years ago, so there's a huge amount that goes on at that point of contact. Where somebody comes into custody, regardless of the reason, then we consider and look at their vulnerabilities and what they are. And certainly one of the things that we would absolutely be on heightened alert for would be being a potential victim of trafficking as well. But Elaine can talk you through the actual process of how that is when somebody attends.
Happy to give you an overview of what goes on. So obviously we know the process when mayors are contracted by the Home Office to provide the accommodation, and then migrant and help are the first point of contact. We work really closely, and I'll go on about collaboration because it's the only way forward. And we work really closely with the Scottish Refugee Council and British Red Cross. In fact, I have a meeting with them once a month, with themselves and Glasgow City Council, the Health and Social Care Partnership, social work and ourselves. And we look at these processes and challenges that have been presented to each of the agencies. Again, just to highlight what Claire said, the Scots law is translated into 10 languages, which we have. We have the interpreters provided when they come to the police offices when that's required. They're processed in five stations with the live scan, and three of them are always staffed at the moment. That's only within Glasgow. The immigration will attend, and the really reassuring part from a police officer point of view is that we will create an interim vulnerable person. We have an interim vulnerable person database, and we create a record for every person who's been brought into the police office, and we're able to then share that with our public protection concern hub, who then can share it with the social work. So that will almost tie in all of the points to make sure that the correct agencies are there at the right time to provide the right support. I'm happy to take any more questions.
So I'm grateful for that answer. I think in terms of that, the record keeping and the passing of information, I'm also particularly interested in the justification, if you like, for passing information to the Home Office, you know, straight away, even if someone is saying they've been a victim of, you know, a serious crime like human trafficking. Would you not view that it might be more appropriate to find a system where we pass that to a solicitor in the first instance, or we have a discussion with a solicitor or a trusted NGO rather than going straight to the Home Office, which could then result in very quickly, you know, removal order coming through and that process kicking in? So would you recognise that there are issues around information sharing? I think Police Scotland have previously said it's about safeguarding the victims, but I don't think, you know, a lot of people would recognise that as being the best way to protect people.
To post new bill or just now?
So I think in terms of the legislative, we're talking about the legislative context of what the bill would do.
Mm-hmm. Ultimately, it isn't for us to comment on at what point anything would be passed. The legislation that, as an organisation, as I say, we want to protect the vulnerable, but we do work within the confines of the law. What we will do is we will continually review the legislation, the legislative changes as well as they come in, and we'll understand what the risks are, what the threats are, and we'll make sure that we can protect those individuals that come into our care. But we do work within the confines of the law, and we wouldn't comment on changes to be made.
And is it a case, because obviously it does happen currently as well, you know, so we have heard of cases where, you know, information has been passed to the Home Office and, you know, there's been removal papers served, for example, whilst people are in process. Would you recognise that?
I would have to go away and speak to our human trafficking unit. It's not my area of business, but I can certainly find that information out for you.
Okay, I think that would be useful. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Paul. Can I bring Fulton in, please?
Yeah, thanks, Convener. And I'm just wanting to follow on from my colleague Paul O'Kane there. And it's in that area about access to services and support. I'm wondering what more, perhaps up yourself, Brona, what more do you think the Scottish Government and local authorities can do to increase the consistency of support the asylum seekers receive? And do you think it would be beneficial if a lot more was free at the point of access, for example, bus passes? I know it's quite a broad question, but I'm trying to find another way to ask the similar area that Paul was in.
I can speak about survivors of trafficking and their experience of asylum. So comes down to everything, doesn't it? More resources means better, more intensive support for vulnerable people and taking that trauma-informed approach. We certainly would be supportive of free travel. I'm very supportive of that, Kane. We already use some of our funds to provide women with bus passes because it's essential for the recovery in terms of minimising social isolation, being able to access education and other opportunities. So we would be supportive of that. What we have found beneficial, I think, for the women that we support is that one-to-one support over a period of time, which builds up that trust and engagement and enables that safety net to be in place. Access to interpreting as well, that is available. There can be shortages of good quality interpreters. I think we've all experienced that. I've certainly, our sympathies have been with Police Scotland in terms of access to particular languages and getting access to an interpreter at that time. We've experienced that too. So I think local authorities and Scottish Government, I think it is about understanding and ensuring that the individuals who are vulnerable are at the centre of what we do and resourcing services to meet those individual needs as best possible.
And how do you think local authorities and I suppose government at a wider level can be ahead of the game, if you like, with that and know what interpreters are needed? Is there, how do you think that information could be shared so that a local authority, for example, like North Lanarkshire Council, where I represent, could be aware and say, look, you know, here is the interpreters that might be required. Who do you think would be able to provide that information? Would that be government or would that be third sector?
If I'm honest, I don't know who would hold that centrally, and that makes me wonder whether we need some kind of national good practice guidance around use of interpreters. Certainly Glasgow's Violence Against Women Partnership have got good practice guidance about the use of interpreters, and I think in Glasgow support providers are quite closely linked, so we're able to be aware of where there are shortages. I think it is for interpreting services and firms to look at what they can do to encourage more people to become interpreters and professionalise that service as well. But I think interpreters are a huge challenge, and it's not just about access to them, it's about the quality of interpreting and how we use our language to support that interpreter to interpret. So an example around trafficking is human trafficking is not easily interpretable. It's not like for like. So we have to be quite careful about how we explain that and just keeping our language simple for interpreters, and that the interpreters are of a good quality and standard as well. We've had women tell us to ask us to stop an interview who have then said that interpreter was appalling. He didn't understand or she didn't understand what I was saying. Could we get another one? So that's definitely something that I think we need to consider.
Yeah, and it strikes me as something that I could imagine would be a really difficult and complicated issue. I mean, even from personal experience. I recently held an event for Ukrainian refugees who have settled in Coatbridge, a large number. So we held the event, we got all the folk in place, but unfortunately the interpreter who was due to come couldn't make it on the day. And myself and the MP were about to address the refugees that came. And it just so happened that a lady who was there was able to actually do it. But we actually had that experience, and I thought, well, you know, is a massive issue. So I suppose moving on from that, for Claire and Elaine, is that something that you recognise what Bronan said there about interpreters? If you're having to deal with people in a sort of a police basis, is that an issue, or do you always get access to people?
Essentially, are probably managed slightly differently for us in terms of checks and balances that need to come in. So we work closely and pulling all that together in terms of making sure we've got the vetting and everything in place as well, because they're obviously accessing vulnerable people. And it's an area that we continually look at. In terms of understanding
the different languages or type of interpreters that we might need, then we continually kind of obviously horizon scan in terms of, for example, the Ukrainian war, and from that perspective, then we would look to try and manage accordingly if we needed to kind of change need and demand as a thing that's managed centrally by, it's a matter that's managed centrally by my own team anyway. So we would probably address that understanding the different need and languages via, you know, horizon scanning and understanding what community tensions there were, and if we had to address that, address it in that way.
Are we all right? I'm just conscious of the time as well.
I did have one more question, but I'm just the time. That's okay. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you for your understanding. Thank you very much to the panel. You've provided some very valuable information and context there. If my colleagues do have further questions that we want more information on, we'll put that in writing to you, and I'm sure that you'll be more than happy to provide us with further evidence. I hope that satisfies anybody that didn't get to come in on this session. So I thank the witnesses once again for their evidence this morning. And we will suspend briefly to allow time for a changeover of witnesses. Thank you. Thank you. We will resume with our next panel of witnesses, three of whom are joining us remotely this morning. I welcome to the meeting Gail Finlay, Policy Manager at COSLA, who is with us remotely. I see Gail. Thomas Glenn, who is the Chief Executive of Perth and Kinross Council. Thomas is also online. Dr. Nina Carruth, Consultant Clinical Psychologist, Glasgow Psychological Trauma Services, NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde, who is with us in person. Welcome. Louise Long, who is the Chief Executive of Inverclyde Council, who is with us in person. Welcome. And Suzanne Miller, the Chair of the Scottish Asylum Dispersal Partnership Board and Chief Office, Glasgow City Health and Social Care Partnership, who is joining us remotely this morning. And I am aware, Suzanne, that you will have to leave us slightly before the end of our allocated time. Thank you for all of you, and welcome. I will invite each of our witnesses to make a very brief opening remark, if they wish to, and then we will move to questions. And I will start with Gail Finlay, please.
Thank you for inviting me to the committee to give evidence to your panel. As you said, I'm a policy manager at COSLA, where I am the policy lead for various humanitarian protection schemes, but also including asylum. At COSLA, we have a number of roles that we undertake in relation to asylum and other protection programmes. We represent the interests and views of local government in Scotland at both a political and officer level, as well as providing support to local authorities participating and impacted by humanitarian protection schemes. We are also have the role of a strategic migration partnership for Scotland, one of 11 across the UK, and we're funded to provide a facilitation role around the various schemes, humanitarian protection schemes. This does include asylum. We participate at a national level, advocating on behalf of local government in the role of dispersal and particularly in the rollout of full dispersal. We also work around issues with Home Office, MIRS, Police Scotland, Health Partners and the Third Sector alongside our local authority colleagues. We represent the role of local government in their approach to full dispersal, which you will understand will have a significant impact in Scotland. As part of our role, we support the structures within Scotland that have strategic oversight of asylum. This includes the Asylum Partnership Board, chaired by Suzanne Miller, who is on your panel today. The committee may also wish to note that all 32 political leaders of our Scottish local authorities have maintained a commitment to participating in various humanitarian protection programmes. This includes full dispersal. Whilst we know there are many challenges with each of the programmes, the significance of this should not be underestimated. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Gail. Could I ask that, Dr. Nina Carruth, please?
Thank you. So my name is Dr. Nina Carruth. I'm a consultant clinical psychologist at the Glasgow Psychological Trauma Service. So we're a tertiary level mental health service which offers psychological and multidisciplinary interventions to people who present with complex post-traumatic stress disorder following experiences of complex trauma. And as a service, we work with some of the most vulnerable and marginalised individuals in societies, including those who are seeking asylum and refugees. I'm the lead within our service to respond to asylum seekers and refugees, and we also hold a national contract under the Support and Recovery Strategy for Victims of Trafficking. I really welcome the invitation to come to the committee today and support the position that the true measure of any society can be found in how it treats its most vulnerable members. I've been really encouraged to see the recent committees and the gathering of evidence from our colleagues who work within this area. I would note that we are profoundly aware in our service of the difficult and traumatic experiences that asylum seekers and refugees have faced. And I would note that they're not a homogenous group. They come from many countries, will have had different experiences in their home countries, experiences on their journey to the UK, and also whilst here in the UK and Scotland. But I'll do my best to represent the key issues and themes as they arise. The context of traumatic experiences is that they've fled their countries due to persecution and threats to their life. This can include experiences of physical violence, sexual violence, imprisonment, torture, war, persecution and exploitation. They also face multiple losses of their home, their families, their communities, their identity and their roles. And the journey to seek safety can also be traumatic. And then arriving in a new country and navigating the asylum system can be challenging. We know as a result of these, there are elevated rates of mental health difficulties among this population, and that can include depression and suicidality, anxiety, PTSD and complex PTSD. Our role is to try and build internal psychological safety, that people would have ways of understanding their experience and having ways of coping with the distress that they experience in the present, processing the past and building a meaningful future. It's very difficult for asylum seekers to do this in the challenging circumstances where it's often difficult to meet their basic human needs and have external safety. I would seek for responses that go beyond problem solving to be transformative. I'm continually impressed by the people that I work with who have experienced significant trauma and yet are able to transform these experiences and continue to live their lives. It's remarkable and an example to us all. I think that this fits with the Scottish Government agenda of being a trauma-informed nation, one where we can transfer the impact of psychological trauma.
Thank you. Could I ask Thomas Glenn, please?
Good morning, Chair, and thank you for the invitation to attend this morning's session. I'm the Chief Executive at Perth and Kinross Council, and this morning hope to be able to provide you with a perspective from one of Scotland's smaller cities and a rural authority on the impact of refugees and asylum seekers in our communities. As a local authority, we have a history of supporting refugee programmes, previous asylum seeker programmes as well. In relation to refugees, we've supported Afghani programmes, Syrians and unaccompanied minors. And in November 2021, we were one of the authorities out with the main cities who were, I would suggest, invited, but probably more likely instructed, to accommodate asylum seekers through the Home Office and Mayor's programme. We have seen around 120 individual males accommodated in Perth in hotels over that period. And through the council, public agencies and a range of community and voluntary sectors have sought to do what we can within our limited remit to assist those individuals during their time in Perth and Kinross. More widely and more recently in relation to refugee support, Perth and Kinross has become home to around 500 Ukrainians over the last year through the Homes for Ukraine and Super Sponsor Scheme. And again, the arrival of those individuals, whilst I think largely positive in the area, has created some challenges for services in terms of the demands placed upon them. So happy to be here and to offer any contribution that we can.
Thanks. Thanks, Thomas. Could I ask Louise, please?
Thank you for inviting me to give evidence this morning. I'm Louise Long. I'm the Chief Executive of Inverclyde Council. Inverclyde is known as being a warm and welcoming place, and this is evident through our long experience of settling families from Afghanistan and Syria. We have worked in partnership with COSLA, Scottish Government, Home Office and Mayors in the last 18 months to open a hotel and also to have some flatted accommodation in Inverclyde. In that time, we have obviously supported the national and international Ukrainian displacement and have supported a number of people through a hotel, through flats and also through the super sponsor scheme. Whilst Inverclyde's statutory, third sector and communities have welcomed these initiatives, it's fair to say for a small area this has created some challenges. However, we continue to work in partnership with the Asylum Partnership Board, which Suzanne Miller is the chair of, where all agencies work collaboratively together in order to ensure that dispersal is recognisable and is proportionate. In Inverclyde, we have a higher level of rented accommodation, and that has the potential to have a disproportionate impact on the number of asylum seekers we can take in Inverclyde. Therefore, it is important that any dispersal or any asylum-seeking accommodation that we find is managed and is done in a way that supports the asylum seekers but also supports our communities. We have also, like other local authorities across Scotland, understand the importance and the richness that new people new to Scotland bring. Through our Afghan and our Syrian families, we have welcomed a number of families into our community, and we will continue to play an active part.
Thank you. Thank you, Louise. Suzanne Miller, please.
Convener, and again, thank you for the invite to attend this morning. Just briefly, on behalf of the city, I've been involved in asylum and refugee work since 2006 in Glasgow City, and we're a very proud city in terms of our work on asylum and refugee issues. We have been a dispersal city for over 20 years within Glasgow City, and as I say, I have been involved in that since 2006, but we still have the team who met the first ambulance plane from Kosovo a number of years ago that began our engagement in asylum and refugee work. So I'm very close to the work that we've undertaken in the city. Like Louise, our experience in Glasgow City is, whilst it has come with its challenges, our asylum and refugees coming to the city and settling here have brought a richness and diversity and changed our city much for the better. And we will continue to welcome asylum and refugee seekers into our city despite the challenges. I also, in my capacity as chair of the Asylum Partnership Board, work with colleague local authorities, with mayors and with the Home Office, as you heard in the previous evidence, to work really hard in a very difficult space to continue collaborative working, make sure that as a nation, within Scotland, we are able to do our very best for the people seeking sanctuary in our country. As I say, that is not without its challenges. However, it's been my experience working in this field for a long number of years that it's worth all of the challenges that it brings with it. Those relationships with the Home Office and with the Westminster Government have at times been extremely difficult. I'm working within a space as local authorities where we are having to manage a significant lack of alignment, shall I say, in terms of the UK government and our own government here in Scotland, has meant at points that we have a very strained relationships. However, I remain convinced as chair of the Asylum Partnership Board that we need to continue to work in that difficult space, to continue to work collaboratively and to be solution focused in all the work that we do. Again, very happy to be here this morning, Convener.
Thank you. Thank you, Suzanne, for that. In the interest of time, we're just going to crack straight on, if that's all right. And I've asked colleagues if they could go into questions. And the Vice Convener, Maggie Chapman, is going to go first. Maggie?
Thank you very much, Kirkab, and good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us and for your opening statements. I want to explore in a little bit more detail the use of hotel accommodation for asylum seekers. Thomas, if I can come to you, you indicated that you felt it was more of an instruction rather than an invitation to accommodate asylum seekers in a hotel in your local authority. Could you just say a little bit about the experience you have in dealing with MIAs and the Home Office, and what are the challenges that you find in being able to provide the support, or that you see the challenges in the support gaps that asylum seekers might have in hotels?
Is that for Thomas? Is Thomas online?
Thomas, please. Yeah. Yeah.
Just checking, Chair, you can hear me okay.
Yeah. I can hear you now.
That's good. So my initial comments about when we were introduced to the MIAs and Home Office programme was very much at short notice. We were advised that we would be receiving in the first tranche up to 70 individual males to be accommodated in a hotel in central Perth. We were told that would happen within the space of a couple of days. And we went back to advise that we felt that was an inappropriately short period to allow us to work with partners to prepare for the arrival. That arrival was still during COVID. There were a number of health and social care implications, as well as wider implications, that we felt needed to be managed for that number of individuals coming into the community. I have to say that that first couple of weeks were probably the most difficult. Subsequent, the local mayor's presence has been very positive on the whole in terms of how they have engaged with partners. We have a system locally that brings together partners from the council, from the Health and Social Care Partnership, colleagues in Police Scotland, who I know were given evidence earlier on, and from a range of community and third sector partners. And we have sought to work where we can to make the experience of those individuals who are there now, and we have under 120 with us in Perth just now. But we recognise that we have limited opportunities to offer anything more than a range of activities to make the time as productive as we can. But for 120 individual men living in Perth, we know that there are a lack of things for them to be able to engage with, and with some of them have been in the same accommodation for over a year.
Thanks, Thomas. If I can just explore that point a little bit more. One of the things that we've heard in previous weeks in our evidence gathering is the relationship that councils have to have with the third sector, and obviously the support and other. It's not just about support, it's about having things to do that you mentioned. Do you think that there's a challenge, particularly for local authorities and areas that aren't in the central belt, don't have the access to that sort of broader ecology of support and activities that maybe those in the central belt do? Do you think there's something particular there that we need to be thinking about when we do have Scotland-wide dispersal systems?
I think there's probably a kind of two sides to this. I think we work with much smaller numbers than colleagues in the central belt, Louise and Suzanne. So the numbers that we're working with, whilst they have an impact at a local level just because we don't have the same availability of accommodation and possibly even the same availability in terms of the numbers of organisations, that can be a challenge. But on the other side, it tends to be much easier to work across those organisations. We have very, very positive relationships with a range of community and voluntary organisations in Perth and wider Perth and Kinross. Organisations like PCAF, our third sector interface, organisations like Saints in the Community, aligned with St Johnstone Football Club, and the local Leisure Trust, they have all been instrumental in providing, at no cost, I have to say, support and assistance. So that does create pressures for those organisations, because often that's been done on the basis of trying to provide the best experience for individuals who are living in our communities. But there are individuals that we know in that community who have skills, who have talents, who have tried to apply those by doing some volunteering, by working with community organisations, but clearly haven't been in that situation for over a year in some instances. It's challenging to maintain an active and enjoyable lifestyle over that period. So I think there are challenges for any community to maintain that number of individuals without any meaningful opportunities to engage with the wider community.
Thanks, Thomas. Gail, if I could come to you now, just from your experience working both within COSLA and seeing what's happening across different local authorities, what do you think we should be thinking about doing better or differently to ensure that we get, particularly where there are hotels, or that we get integration between the asylum seekers that are being supported, hopefully, in hotels, and the immediate local communities, and then the wider local authority area? What are the key challenges or key asks that you would have?
Thank you. And I think picking up Thomas's point around the speed at which the first hotels were established meant that planning was quite difficult. And as Thomas said, the first few weeks of that kind of process was probably the hardest. What we're seeing now, and this is partly because of Suzanne's role at a national level and COSLA's role at a national level, is that we in Scotland seem to have a much more planned approach to this. So local authorities are being given notice, sometimes months in advance of potential hotels being stood up, which does enable there to be more planning in place. And we've seen that in a couple of regions that are have just had hotels stood up where they've been able to communicate slightly more freely. Previously, there was very little communication with the community and community organisations, so that does help. But I think ultimately it's one of resource, because there is no money attached to any of the kind of asylum hotels. So there is an expectation that community groups and local authorities are providing all these services for free. So if there are spaces on ESOL classes, great if people can get in, but there's no additional funding from any source to be able to provide that, whether that's a college or a community organisation. But I think ultimately, until we see a significant uplift in the resourcing around asylum, there's going to be a lot of it is going to be done on the goodwill, of which there is much in Scotland, of services and community groups. There is recently a very small amount of funding attached to the increase of dispersal beds, but that is fairly minor and certainly wouldn't pay for any medium to long term interventions in a local authority area.
Thanks, Gail. That's really helpful. And I think your point about resourcing, and it's resourcing for both the public and third sectors there is well made. My final question, if I can come to you, Suzanne, just about some of the situation in Glasgow. Obviously, you've got decades of experience in a way that other local authorities do not, and also, but with that experience comes the burden of having to deal with more and maybe some of the more complex situations. I'm wondering whether you could reflect on the tragedy in the Park Inn Hotel, and whether you think across the piece we've actually learnt the lessons that we needed to learn from that, and what changes haven't been made yet that we should be looking to make, and what else do we need to be thinking about to ensure that we don't see a repeat of that or a similar incident, but that we actually are genuinely being trauma-informed in our support for asylum seekers.
Thanks. The question, and yes, you're right, we've seen that there's been a significant amount of complexity. I suppose that was what I was reflecting on that my opening remarks, always outweighed by the positivity, but we've had some difficult times in the city. And just in terms of numbers, I should have said in my opening remarks, at any one time we've got somewhere in the region of 5,500 asylum seekers in the city. And in comparison, and proportionately across the UK, remain among the highest, and it points the highest proportionately in terms of asylum dispersal. And then obviously we recently added our Ukrainian population to that. Lots of experience in that space. Specifically in relation to the Park Inn, I suppose a couple of comments I would make. We did, as a Health and Social Care Partnership, along with colleagues in the Scottish Refugee Council, actually undertake a review of all of the people who had been accommodated within the Park Inn. And you'll know that our teams were involved in supporting mayors during those really difficult times in terms of the move that evening of those people from Park Inn down to the alternative hotel accommodation. And we actually based our teams in that alternative hotel. And as I say, we took the opportunity, because we're only engaged as a Health and Social Care Partnership with those people who are meeting the thresholds for health and social care services, so we're not by definition involved in the kind of universal population, although previously held the contract, so have been in the past. But we worked with SRC and we undertook that assessment. The outcome of that was, for us, I think, some reassurance that when people were being referred to our health services or indeed our social work services, we were responding appropriately as a health and social care partnership. But a real concern from us and our psychologist from the trauma service also touched on it in her opening remarks the mental health and wellbeing of the asylum population was not being well served by the accommodation and support contract the Home Office had with Mayors. Not a negative comment on Mayors as a provider, but it's actually, it wasn't recognised within the contractual arrangements. And for us, we were really clear. So we restated our protocols in terms of referrals to ourselves and to make sure that they were clear. But our bigger concern was that mental health and wellbeing, that people are not meeting the thresholds for statutory intervention. And we put a proposal together in terms of what we thought was required there. It was similar to our Tier 1 mental health services, our community-based mental health services. Based on our experience, we put a proposal together and tried very hard to get the Home Office to fund that. And unfortunately, we were unsuccessful in that, but luckily we were successful in getting the Scottish Government to agree to fund that. So we're currently working on a pilot project funded by the Scottish Government in relation to that mental health and wellbeing element. And I think for us, despite, as I say, that frontline Mayor staff working hard and focused on welfare, there wasn't the focus on mental health and wellbeing, in our opinion, that they're required to be. And I think that would probably continue to be a concern of ours. So what we've had to do, supported by COSLA, is work on this pilot project to be funded by the Scottish Government. And I would hope that we'll be able to demonstrate that that this project would support that mental health and wellbeing, and therefore should then become our argument. It's likely to be that should become part of the contractual arrangements that the Home Office has with providers. But yeah, that was one of the most difficult ways to be at work that day.
Yeah, no, I can imagine. Thanks for that, Suzanne, and thank you for your candour in your response. I think one of our challenges is that balance. And we've already discussed the tensions between the different approaches to support from the different governments and different layers involved. So hearing that is really helpful. Kirkab, I'll leave it there, mindful of time. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks very much for that. Can I just pick up on a couple of points just for clarity? So we've heard that sometimes we get lots of notice. I think that Thomas was saying there was 2 days' notice for the arrival of asylum seekers and refugees. I'm not sure who the best person to answer is. What is it? Are there some incidents where it's less than that? Because, I mean, I have heard anecdotally that some authorities have had, like, about 12 hours' notice of a hotel being used for asylum seekers and refugees. So I wonder, Gail, would you be able to sort of quickly just give me an idea of what the longest period of notice and what the shortest period of notice you've had?
So I think, as Thomas said, they were one of the first hotels outside of Glasgow to be established in 2021. And the hotels that were established around that time all received a similar amount of notice of 2-3 days.
Oh, you've frozen a little bit there.
And there's been more recent procurement over the last 6 months. And there we've seen more of a picture of 4 weeks notice for hotels being established. And in fact, some hotels even longer, but that's to do with contracts not being signed, etc., rather than a delay on the will of the Home Office. I think where we see a slightly different picture in Scotland than we do down south, so in England, and Suzanne will be able to attest this as well, is that in England, they see hotels stood up and then the local authority told after the event. I think because of the long-standing relationship and good open relationship that ourselves and local authorities have with Mayors means that we do seem to get more early notice. And that's not something that we wish to kind of go back on. But our colleagues in England, I think, would tell a very different story. So I think because of that relationship in Scotland, we're a much smaller area. People know what's going on and Mayors value the partnership with local authorities and so wish to maintain a good relationship with us all.
Thanks, Gail. Just in the interest of time, if I could just ask for as much succinct in your answers, that would be great. Louise, you indicated that you wanted to come in, and I'm aware that Suzanne wants to come in as well. Louise?
Thank you very much. It's just to say, from the Inverclyde perspective, actually, we were notified at the time of the local elections. And so we went back to mayors and the Home Office, and we were able to negotiate 4 weeks because we didn't actually have a council. And therefore, we needed to inform our elected members and work alongside them. But they did give us 4 weeks in order to work alongside our elected members and our local communities. And I've got to say, we have an excellent relationship with mayors locally, who I think are doing a sterling job.
Suzanne?
Yeah, just to add to that, I think this is one of the areas where we have managed to operate in that really difficult space with colleagues in the Home Office in terms of the difference. I represent the Scottish Local Authority Chief Execs and the UK-wide structures convener in relation to asylum and refugee. And just particularly just now, there's real pressure in the system, and those are weekly meetings with chief execs across the UK, and it is materially different here in terms of that, in terms of the notice that we get. So just really to support colleagues to say it is different, and we have worked really hard in terms of that human relationship that we have with a number of folk within the Home Office and mayors to use that to get the best that we possibly can for people who are settling here in Scotland.
Thank you. Thanks for that. I'm going to pass over to my colleague Pam, please.
Thank you, Chair, and thank you, panel, for your opening statements. In previous sessions, witnesses have referred to the difference between the resettlement of Ukrainian refugees in comparison with other refugees and asylum seekers, often painting the picture that Ukrainian refugees are treated more favourably. However, over the weekend, it was revealed that more than 7,500 Ukrainian refugees are still in temporary accommodation, and some are moved around the country. Can you talk a little bit more about that? Would you say that the Scottish Government overestimated their ability to cope with the number of refugees? And what impact do you think the drastic shortage of housing has had on the ability to provide more stable accommodation in a community-based setting? And could I ask Gail that question and then Thomas, if it's okay? Thank you.
Thank you for your question. So you're absolutely right to make the distinction between the various resettlement and asylum processes. Resettlement, as you'll be aware, in 2015, took on a whole new kind of face in Scotland with all local authorities participating. But that was a funded programme with matching happening outside of country, and people were placed within a local authority area with preparation on both sides. Compared to asylum, where local authorities have no say or very little say over where people are placed and have no kind of active role unless they meet certain vulnerability criteria in their day-to-day life. So as Suzanne explained around the park-in incident, you know, naturally the local authority wouldn't have had much contact with individuals in that hotel. I think Ukraine is, again, a different system. It's the first time we've had a Scottish Government-run system with the super sponsorship scheme. And clearly the numbers in hotels is concerning, and as you rightly point out, is down to the lack of available housing, not just in social rented sector, but also in the private rental sector, and the cost of that accommodation. Without the accommodation, the moving on of people is going to be very difficult and very challenging. We've seen that also with the Afghan scheme, and you'll be aware that there are a number of hotels in Scotland with Afghan families in who are still looking for homes across the UK. That picture isn't just the same in Scotland. Ukraine adds to the pressure in Scotland. That's the uniqueness we have in Scotland and Wales around Ukraine. And definitely having that number of people arrive in that space of time is something that Scottish partners, whether it's government, third sector or local government, had never experienced before.
Thank you, Gail. Could I ask Thomas the same question, and obviously Louise as well from Inverclyde? Thanks.
Yep, thanks for the question. I'll pick up on some of Gail's comments, but Maybe just to begin with a little bit about the full dispersal scheme and the implications that that will have, because I think, like Louise said, our relationship with MERS has been a positive one after the initial challenges. If full dispersal is rolled out, then that will absolutely add to the pressures that Gail had highlighted in terms of the wider housing pressures across Scotland. And we have particular challenges in a rural authority where we don't have anything like the same level of affordable housing. I think we're about 16% compared to a national average of about 26% affordable housing provision in our local authority area. So that's already got a challenge. The Ukrainian programme, super sponsor programme, has exacerbated that, in our opinion, in Perth and Kinross. It does create that. But having said that, we've had some fantastic experiences where communities have come together and really welcomed Ukrainian refugees into our areas. And I'd cite probably the opportunities in Aberfeldy, around about Feldiru, a community-based organisation who have been instrumental in bringing many of the 470 Ukrainians that we've got in Perth and Kinross just now. So yes, there is a challenge in terms of the whole range of humanitarian programmes on top of what we see as a housing pressure in our part of rural Scotland in particular. And as an example, we can see a one-bedroom flat in Perth and Kinross on the market for £90,000 in a rural part of Perthshire just now, selling for nearly £200,000 from a buyer from down south or from overseas. And that pressure for affordable housing is a very real pressure over and above whatever's been added into the system through through the current refugee programme and potentially through the full dispersal programme, which MERS will have to manage at a later date.
Thank you, Thomas. Louise?
Through yourself, convener. I suppose one of the unique things about Inverclyde is that we have housing. However, we are a small local authority, and that's why in my opening statement I talked about it needs to be managed, and it needs to be managed well. One of the issues for us is we've got a lot of socio-economic challenges in Inverclyde, and therefore we have gradually, a bit like we did with the Afghan and Syrian families, gradually taken families, developed housing, developed support so that the community is not overwhelmed, but also, very importantly, that we provide the right type of support to those who are seeking asylum in Scotland and those who are new Scots. I would also say that actually as a local authority, we might be slightly unique in the fact that our HSCP and our local and the council provide services into the hotel in Inverclyde. And that is because we need to manage some of the community engagement so that there's enough, because in a small area there isn't always facilities for everyone. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I just ask a supplementary on that, Louise? So that's brilliant that you're providing those services. Who's paying for those? Which budget is that coming out of?
So the community learning and development team provide English lessons in the hotel, because I think someone said earlier in their opening statement, our education college also provides services. The council pays for that. And from our health and social care partnership, we support the third sector. Who are supported to put in what we call care navigators, people who signpost people to all the different services, whether that be the football, gyms, and there's a range of free activities that are involved in Inverclyde, and obviously that's provided by the Health and Social Care Partnership.
Okay, so the money for asylum seekers and refugees, that all goes to MERS. So this isn't just directed at you. I mean, it may be that Suzanne might be in a good position to answer this as well. So none of that money actually goes to local authorities, but the local authorities are providing all the peripheral services that are required. Would that be correct? A yes, or, you know, a brief answer to that would be absolutely fine. Please?
Yes. Yeah. Like okay. For anyone who lives in the local authority area, we make sure, just as health does, that they have access to services.
Yeah, which is absolutely fantastic that councils are doing that. But I suppose my point is like they're not getting any of the money that's allocated for that. That was the point I was trying to get to. Thomas, I saw you nodding your head. Was that in agreement that you don't receive any funds?
Absolutely. I mean, MERS have the contract. The individuals in these hotels, as I understand, have £8 a week or thereabouts to live on. We don't get that direct funding, but there is a cost that our council, like Louise's council, and our voluntary and community sector are bearing to ensure that these individuals get the best of opportunities that they can. Can I cite one other little thing, because it's not been mentioned, but the importance of faith communities is important here. Perth has a small Islamic community that's been there for many years. We don't have a mosque in Perth other than a small three-bedroom residential property that's been converted. The arrival of the asylum seekers into Perth brought many individuals who were from an Islamic faith. That created a pressure on the local mosque that couldn't be accommodated. We had people attending for Friday prayer, praying on stairs, praying in bathrooms, praying in kitchens. As a council, we worked with the mosque and we provided them with access to the council's civic hall on Fridays for civic prayer. And it was fantastic. Just last couple of weeks when we were celebrating Eid Mubarak, we had almost 200 individuals in the civic hall. So there is a real role for the mosque and for faith communities to support that, and they've done a fantastic job in terms of providing a whole range of supports to individuals in our city.
Thanks, Thomas, for raising that. It's a really important point. Can I bring in Paul? Are you happy to be brought in just now?
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to the second panel. I think just building on that point about ESOL provision, because I think this is quite important, I wonder if Gail Finlay could maybe comment just on the provision of ESOL across Scotland. Obviously, we don't have an ESOL strategy anymore, but it would be useful to understand what is COSLA's position in terms of who should be responsible for delivering that ESOL, because I think provision is patchy, it's fair to say, and that's to nobody's detriment, it's just that there isn't a kind of concerted strategy.
Thank you for your question. So in terms of ESOL, we would have liked to have seen the continuation of an ESOL strategy. It was an important, I guess, building block for what previously was really good practice. It was recognised across the UK and has been copied by Wales and England. And we now seem to have stepped back from that, which is disappointing. In terms of the funding is very limited that goes to colleges and it should be through the ESOL partnership shared out between providers in a local authority. So whether that is a local authority or the college or third sector, depending on what the need is. I think what we have seen due to cuts and excuse me, some of the constraints around what's acceptable learning targets, we have seen a lot of that kind of entry level and kind of the informal learning which people benefit from when they first arrive in the country cut. I'm also aware that there are huge waiting lists across the whole of Scotland, and there are good examples of where colleges, local authority and third sector work in partnership, but I think we are basically suffering from a very significant lack of resources in that area, and the increase in demand has, you know, with Ukraine, asylum, Afghan, has increased. I can't even estimate how much, but the waiting lists are significant, and that is one of the real concerns around the lack of an ESOL strategy. And I guess as part of the new Scots strategy and work, that is something that we have worked with Scottish Government to try and address, but we've not moved forward significantly at all on that.
And I wonder if I can, just on that, Gail, do you think the end of the strategy, was that a financial issue in terms of funding, or was it just that it was felt that it would be better to integrate that into other strategies?
Obviously, I can't speak on behalf of Scottish Government colleagues that make that decision, but our understanding was that it was because they wanted it integrated into the adult learning strategy, and therefore the ESOL is mentioned in the adult learning strategy, but it's a very, very small part. The funding sits separately to that and sits with, obviously, the Scottish Funding Council.
Okay, thank you. I wonder, convener, if I can, just to Louise Long, obviously, you touched on the ESOL provision in a community like Inverclyde, and I think it can be challenging because I think people would very often rather keep things local and keep everyone in the community. But very often I know that people might have to travel to Glasgow and other places. What is your ESOL provision like in terms of from either Community Learning Development or West College Scotland? And what would enhance that for you in terms of Inverclyde's provision?
Through yourself, Convener. The college provide ESOL. And our CLD team also provide a provision actually in the hotel. There aren't the kind of waiting lists that there might be in other places, but that comes back to the point that I'm making about it being managed and us making sure we could always do more ESOL provision and getting specialist support into Inverclyde can sometimes be difficult. And as the panel will know, there's difficulties with people travelling who are seeking asylum because of the issue in relation to transport.
Just one more, convener, if I may, and it's on a slightly different topic, but because Ms Long is here, and as obviously as a West Region member, I'm particularly interested in the implementation of New Scots strategy in Inverclyde, because obviously Inverclyde is a community where there is an issue around declining population in certain communities. Do you see, and does the council see an opportunity, I think, in bringing new families and new in through the New Scots kind of programmes in order to grow communities again? And what work have you done, I think, in terms of bringing communities together to understand the new diversity that might exist in a community that's been perhaps not as diverse as other places in Scotland?
Through yourself, convener. So, for colleagues, we have a third sector organisation called Your Voice, who's done a lot of work in this area and engaging with the communities and within Inverclyde. We've also looked at the Afghan resettlement scheme, and it comes back to that scheme was planned over a few years, so there was funding that went with that scheme, and so we've been able to attract a number of families from Afghan and Syria who have settled in Inverclyde, and we have a big community. We fairly recently had a big event at the Beacon, which you may remember, in what we call our New Scots. And we do see an opportunity if it's managed properly. And there is some challenges because of the size of our school estate, the places that may become available, the housing for families. There's a lot of single occupancies because of the tenants in Inverclyde. And so it all needs to be managed as part of a strategy moving forward.
Thank you, convener.
Fulton?
Thanks, convener. And just following on from my colleague's line of questioning there, in the last session, if you heard some of it, there was a wee bit of a discussion around interpreters and access to interpreters for asylum seekers. I'm wondering if panellists can tell the committee about the provision and use of language interpreters across Scotland. I'm trying to think who might be best in a big panel. Maybe start with yourself, Gail, from a COSLA perspective, and then see where we go from there.
Thank you for your question. So I did catch that part of the last panel, and I think they reflected probably very fairly some of the challenges around access to the assured level of competence of interpreters and translators. Local authorities have contracts with various companies that they will use. NIRS also will have a separate contract that they will use, and as you heard, Police Scotland have their own set of accredited interpreters as well. I would probably pass to one of my local authority colleagues to reflect on their practice locally, because obviously we don't necessarily work specifically with asylum seekers and so don't use interpreter services on a regular basis.
Yeah, thanks for that. I'm happy. Maybe yourself, Louise, would that be all right? I don't propose. I've got three areas of question. I don't propose to ask all five panellists each question. The convener will be glad to hear. So I'm wondering, Louise, if you can pick up on the interpreter issue.
So it's difficult and it is complex. So there's obviously different interpretation services that we can access relatively easily. The NHS can access interpretation services, and MERS has a provision. But sometimes, given some of the language issues, there may well be that it's not easily as accessible as we would like it to be. And there's telephone and there's a whole range of mechanisms in order to support if we come into difficulties.
Okay, thanks.
I just interject. Suzanne has indicated that she'd like to come in. I'd like to bring Suzanne in just now before she has to leave for another meeting.
Thanks, Convener. Just to add, maybe by way of illustration, so in the city we have somewhere in the region of 154 different languages and dialects spoken in our schools as a result of the successful asylum and refugee work that we've done in the city. So that maybe illustrates the scale of the challenge. And it is very similar to ESOL across the country. I think that we don't have the consistency necessarily that we would like in relation to interpreting services. Sometimes it can be difficult to access the very specific languages and dialects. And often, as local authorities or health and social care partnerships, you can be in a set of circumstances with people that are very sensitive. So we need to be really careful in terms of our interpreting services and how we use them. And that's something we have to be constantly vigilant. So there is a constant pressure in terms of availability, but also it's the complexity of our interactions at points with people that means that we have to be really careful. So it's another area whereby I think it would be fair to say every and any local authority in Scotland would welcome additional resource, and that would include the city. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you.
Thanks very much for that, Suzanne, and to the others. I think that we've heard from both the sessions this morning and previously that this is an issue I think that the committee can certainly take forward. I was also wanting to ask about the asylum seekers and refugees that might need mental health support. How available is support for asylum seekers, and do they know and understand that they can access such support? I'm looking at yourself, Dr. Nina, here, maybe if you would be able to come in this bit.
Yeah, so I guess the health service is accessible to asylum seekers and refugees at any stage in them seeking asylum or staying within Scotland. It's the kind of universal provision, and it's through our core business that we respond to the needs of asylum seekers and refugees. Within Glasgow, there's the asylum health bridging team who do the initial health assessments of new arrivals, both physical health and mental health, and would link them in with relevant services. Also, I guess, recognise the role of GP practices and community link workers within Glasgow about supporting the primary care mental health needs of asylum seekers and refugees. For mental health, so our service is a psychological trauma service. We work with people with complex PTSD at the more moderate to severe end. So we would see a large proportion of asylum seekers and refugees who meet our referral criteria. But also the other mental health services in Glasgow would equally respond, if that's primary care or community mental health teams. I think, as other people have touched on, it's about having a trauma-informed approach, about understanding the impact of trauma and how that might present to these populations, and being able to be trauma-responsive in providing specific mental health interventions that meet the mental health requirements. And I would add, it's about being culturally informed and culturally sensitive. So we talk quite casually about mental health now in Scotland, which is great, but not all countries would have the same language or the same understanding for mental health. So even us broaching that with people from different countries, there's some education, information that needs to be done in a sensitive manner. It's maybe about talking about the impact of what they've been through and how that would affect them in their lives now, and what supports might be available that could help them with that. In some countries, mental health might be more of an extreme end, where people are removed and institutionalised, rather than being a broad spectrum of mental health in the way that we might view it. I also really would recognise the value of psychosocial supports and the role of third sector and community supports in doing that. So particularly for trauma, we think about how to build safety as the primary task, and that can be from interventions that provide psychoeducation and ways of coping skills, but it can also be through structure and routine and activities and meaningful engagement. So I think there's a very specific role for mental health services, but there's also a recognition of the broader support that's provided as well.
I think that's a very detailed description of some of the services and the way that they are and can be delivered. So I thank you for that. I'm just wondering, though, if you've got any idea of how much asylum seekers and refugees know that they can access those services. Do you feel that they are accessed regularly and that there is a general understanding that they can be accessed, whether they want to access them or not, it's a different issue? Or do you think there's more that we can do to ensure that that people do understand that they can access that support should they wish to?
Yeah, it's hard to know, isn't it? I mean, we certainly receive regular referrals, so there is awareness and there is people who are accessing services and know how to do that. But I guess it's unknown about other people who don't have that awareness, and you know, certainly maybe the kind of, I don't know what awareness campaigns are, how to kind of build that within community bases, certainly within, I suppose we heard earlier from the trafficking area, and that's an area we have close partnerships from the very start about letting people know about our service and how our service might have a role in supporting their care. And so that's a very kind of clear example where that has worked well. And it might be, thinking more broadly about how can we inform asylum seekers and refugees about the different services available.
Excellent, thank you very much. A final line of question, if that's all right, but I can leave it.
Well, is it all right if we come back? I'm just mindful of time, and if we have time, we will absolutely come back. I'd like to move on to my colleague Rachel, please.
Thank you, Convener. We know, panel, that the numbers of incidences of human trafficking has increased dramatically. I wondered, can the panel members provide examples how their local authorities or their organisations are working to tackle modern slavery in terms of preventative measures and also raising awareness. We heard particular examples of this in the previous session where traffickers were bringing vulnerable women into the country with a promise of employment, and particularly this may be relevant in Perth and Kinross, so I would like to go to Thomas Glenn first, if I may.
Thank you. I heard part of the session earlier on, and maybe just picking up on some of the context from the contributions that were made from Superintendent Dobson, Inspector Tomlinson, and I think it was Ms. Andrew from Tara. There is a context in terms of individuals potentially being nervous about engaging with statutory services, and police colleagues commented about that earlier on. We had the nervousness of people even engaging with health services at the beginning of their arrival in Scotland. So even on things like COVID vaccinations, etc. So immediately we have to get by that sense of nervousness about engaging with us in any issue, let alone anything as potentially complex as human trafficking. So I think that's an important thing for us, just to understand the importance of relationships in this process. Asylum seekers in Perth and Kinross are slightly different in that we currently have 120 individual males in the hotels that we currently have just now. So the direct exposure to individuals who have been trafficked is not something that we've come across in terms of that experience. We do have the structures we have in place with colleagues in Police Scotland and other responders run about things like MARAC and other structures to support women. But in terms of direct experience of those who have been impacted by human trafficking, it's not something we've had a huge experience of in Perth and Kinross.
Thank you. Gail, from COSLA's point of view, through the Equally Safe strategy to eradicate violence against women, what advice have you given to local authorities in terms of raising awareness and encouraging women to, report these terrible situations?
Thank you for your question. The Equally Safe lead sits in a different part of COSLA, but we work quite often quite closely. We also have a modern slavery human trafficking lead within our team as well. They meet regularly with local authorities, and each local authority has responded to the Equally Safe strategy, with many having a specific contact. There is also, you'll be aware, a change in the law about requirements to report suspected trafficking and cases of modern slavery now on local authorities, and that applies to adults and children. And we're working with Scottish Government currently to develop some guidance for local authorities about what that means. And one of the mitigations that the Scottish Government have already put in is the independent child trafficking guardians, which is a follow-on from the Scottish Guardianship Service, which I'm sure you're aware, which tackles initially the issue around children. So that means that anybody who is under 18 who is suspected of victim of trafficking will be given an independent guardian, but also anybody coming through the unaccompanied asylum seeking children services will be given a guardian as well. And those are intended to address some of those concerns that Thomas just said about how people feel about accessing services and some of the kind of suspicion around more formal services like the police or health services. But it is an ongoing piece of work. And obviously you'll have heard lots of evidence earlier and in previous sessions about the potential impact of the illegal immigration bill, and we're not quite sure yet how that's going to play out in terms of those roles and participation in those schemes.
Okay, just to be clear, I'll ask Louise this question if I may. Some of the roles that Gail Finlay was talking about there, and we've heard a lot about the interaction between third sector, possibly social workers, community workers within the council. Those roles will, I presume, always exist. You'll always provide those roles. And is that the interface between asylum seekers at the moment, your interface, just to be clear, in any community cohesion, trying to access services, looking at, you know, being the point of contact where somebody has issues around, perhaps they want to share with them around human trafficking. Are those the right people? Can you just talk us through that?
So human trafficking is a public protection issue, and a public protection issue is dealt with by social workers, and they will always be dealt with by social workers or the police, and sometimes jointly together if it's children through a JII process. We have, in Inverclyde, we have a new to Scotland refugee and migration team, which is multidisciplinary. It has health, it has social work, it has the third sector in. And that team supports anyone, including Ukrainians, Afghans, Syrians, and those in hotels. Like Thomas, predominantly we have about 50 to 60 males in the hotel accommodation. But we have done work with the third sector about raising awareness about human trafficking. Because, as Thomas says, they're unlikely to tell someone they think is official, like the social worker or the police. They're much more likely to build relationships with colleagues in the third sector, and through that, be able to build a relationship, and therefore be able to tell us what's happening in relation to them.
Okay. And have you in Inverclyde had women that have? I mean, you don't have to answer this, but it's just interesting to hear what Thomas Glenn said there about predominantly the asylum seekers are male. Do you have a combination of male and female in Inverclyde, and therefore the potential to have somebody that was possibly being trafficked? You might not know about it, but you have the services there to provide if that so happened.
So we have predominantly male asylum seekers, but every local authority in Scotland has the services to be able to support anybody who's human who's been trafficked, because it's part of our statutory duty to provide care.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks for that. Can I just come in regarding children in hotels, and just to get some clarity on that. Last week, I think it was Andy Cyril from Just Right Scotland, and he mentioned in his evidence that there were unaccompanied children that were housed in a hotel. It wasn't located geographically, but I just wondered, Gail, could I get some kind of idea of what Andy was referring to there, if you can shed any light on that, how many unaccompanied children are local authorities dealing with, and are they mainly in hotels or have they gone on to dispersal accommodation?
So I think there's two separate issues there. So we have seen across the UK with the dispersal of adults into hotels, that some people who either have been kind of the age assessment has been incorrect, or they have not declared that they're under 18 till they've arrived in a hotel. So we have seen, I guess, what we would say is children dispersed as adults into adult hotels. We've seen that only in a couple of occasions in Scotland, in two of our hotels with low numbers. And I'm not being dismissive of it at all because it's extremely serious. It shouldn't happen at all. But in England, they are seeing hundreds and hundreds of children or under 18s being dispersed into adult accommodation. And that is not something we've yet seen in Scotland. I'm not saying we're not going to. I think because the vetting that does go with being in Scotland and the distances people are travelling, we are seeing a slightly higher level of vetting of those arriving in Scotland. Thomas may be able to give you more details on what happened in Perth. But basically, you know, when the situation arrived, immediately it's on the local authority to provide services to those young people, do an age assessment, and then make a decision as to whether they move them out of the hotels immediately or do a full age assessment. It's on a case-by-case basis. In terms of unaccompanied asylum-seeking children, there's a separate programme to asylum dispersal that COSLA oversees. Over the last year, we've had over 300 young people arrived in a planned, if not very quick way to Scotland. So local authorities are allocated a number of young people that they are mandated to take by the UK government. And there is a rota system within Scotland and each local authority, and it does include all 32 local authorities in Scotland, are required to take unaccompanied asylum-seeking children. They may come from an asylum-seeking an unaccompanied asylum-seeking hotel in the south of England or one of the Kent reception units in England that are specifically for children. They then arrive into an organised placement that is provided by the local authority. So there's two separate schemes. So I think you're probably referring to those children that have arrived as the Home Office have decided are adults, but when they arrive in Scotland, they declare that they're children, and then the local authority has to then take care of them. They're two separate schemes, if that makes sense.
Yeah, no, thanks for that clarity. Can I bring in Louise? And since you mentioned Thomas, I will give him the opportunity to come in if he wishes. Louise, please.
Children, unaccompanied children is probably one of the most challenging areas for local authorities. Particularly a local authority like my own, which is small. Currently, we're under a great deal of pressure because of COVID. We have more children who are accommodated, very few spaces in our children's houses or our fostering. However, as Gail said, we are mandated to take children, and we have a responsibility when we take children to make sure they have a good placement, that they are safe, they are given an opportunity to flourish. We don't have any children in any hotels, nor would we. However, I could see this as being a real pinch point in the future, because what may happen in the future is we may take responsibility for children and have no places in Inverclyde and have to place them out with authority at great costs. And actually, the financial costs in relation to unaccompanied children do not pay for the cost of their placement, even in our children's houses.
Thank you for that. Thomas, would you like to come in? I think you're still on. I hear you now.
Thank you. Yeah, I think we're connected. Yeah. Very, very briefly, Gail, as she explained, in terms of unaccompanied asylum-seeking children, that works well. I think it's managed. It's well coordinated, so we haven't had any difficulties in that locally. We have had a small number of instances, a handful, where young men turned out to be children when it was looked at again. And that was picked up very quickly. And we had our youth work services and our children's social work services engaged immediately. And that was picked up and dealt with through conversations with mayors. So whilst the numbers have been relatively small, it has been picked up quickly, but clearly there's a risk in the system if that's happening. The only comment I would add is when we move to full dispersal and mayors are having to manage that and seek accommodation out with hotels, then that could introduce a level of risk in terms of the monitoring of where people are being placed and the potential for adults not to be adults and, in fact, to be children. So it is a risk in terms of the full dispersal programme, we would suggest.
Thank you. Thank you, Thomas. And I'm going to give the last word to Dr. Nina Carruth, please.
So I just wanted to come in about the Glasgow context, because we also respond to the mental health needs of unaccompanied minors and do work with the Social Work Service in Glasgow and the Scottish Guardianship Service. And it's my understanding from working with them and our referrals that there have been unaccompanied minors in hotels in Glasgow just due to the demand and the provisions available. I believe that's being looked at about, you know, how they're placed there, if there's alternatives, and alternatives have been sought. So it might be something to follow up with the Social Work Service there, or the Scottish Guardianship Service, in terms of the numbers or the details. But would recognise, this was raised earlier, that it's not ideal conditions for adults and certainly not for unaccompanied minors either. And so we'd hold concerns about their mental health and wellbeing in those kind of environments.
Thank you. Thank you for that, actually. That does give us more information to go on. We will follow that up. That concludes our formal business this morning, and I thank all of our witnesses for your attendance and for your valuable contributions this morning. Thank you.